Thank you. Hello, good evening, and welcome to our Sunday evening service, this first Sunday of Advent. And we're doing what we do in all these Advent Sunday evenings, singing a couple of hymns back to back at the beginning. You'll notice that from your order of service. And we're thinking particularly of the coming of our Savior in the past and his return again in the future. And as we reflect on the past, these words from Micah: "But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. And he shall stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they shall dwell secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be their peace." Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening in the power and with the help of the Holy Spirit and in our Lord Jesus' name to praise you for him who dwells in everlasting light, he who humbled himself to come to that Bethlehem, he whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days, the everlasting Son, who is our Savior. And we thank you that he has led us into the paths of peace, so that as we gather this evening, we know that we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And we have the peace of God that passes all understanding. And we pray that tonight as we worship, that that would give us great joy and peace in believing. We pray in Jesus' strong name. Amen.
Amen. Please remain standing and we will pray together the prayer of confession found in your bulletin. Let's pray. Our gracious Father, you sent your Son to die and rise to new life in order that death might be destroyed and that we might live a new life. Yet we have often chosen our own way rather than your way. We have rebelled against you in thought, word, and deed. In doing so, we have grieved you, hurt others, and damaged ourselves. Forgive our sin for Jesus' sake, and grant that we may walk in the ways of love and holiness to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Now hear the gospel's assurance of pardon. In him, you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory.
Scripture reading this evening is from Isaiah chapter 7, and verse 10 through 17. You can find that on page 572. That's 572. Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 10. And as is true of our Sunday evenings, we pray that the Spirit of God would not only make the reading of God's word effectual, but the preaching of God's word an effective means of enlightening, convincing, and humbling sinners such as us. It is not a word of man or a word of the church, but is the word of God. Let's pray together. Great God and Father, as we come to your word tonight, would you hide your servant and instrument from our eyes that Christ alone is magnified. It is your word that we so desperately need, not the opinions or platitudes of man. As your people, we are like dry ground, thirsting to be quenched by the rain from heaven. Lord, there is nothing like your word. It is life and wisdom to our soul, and we are broken and lost without it. Would you shepherd each one of us this evening that we may be strengthened in grace and peace, growing in the knowledge of our Savior, that we might be enabled to live for your glory and the good of those around us. We pray this in the magnificent and matchless name of Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 10 through 17. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test." And he said, "Hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary men, but you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Immanuel. He shall eat curds and honey when he knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the boy knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land whose two kings you dread will be deserted. The Lord will bring upon you and upon your people and upon your father's house such days as have not come since the day of Ephraim departed from Judah, the king of Assyria. This is the word of God.
Let's pray. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are truly beyond all splendor, beyond all praising and all telling. And yet, you sent the Son, Christ, to come and become poor. We pray that you would make us as you would have us be, make us to follow in this pattern. To be as Christ with generous hearts. We pray that you would take these offerings and use them so that more people might know you through knowing how Christ has become poor so that they might be rich. We pray this for Philadelphia and throughout the world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated.
Darkness, mourning on their sorrows, Lord. True.
We had an Old Testament reading earlier from Isaiah, and it's appropriate that you find that spot and put your finger there. But we have a New Testament reading from Matthew chapter 1 and reading from verse 18. Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. And we'll be reflecting back, at least for a while, to the Isaiah passage. But this is the heart of our message tonight. Familiar words. Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Immanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Joseph will not get much press this Christmas. Oh, he'll be around, of course. He often seems no more than a prop, a necessary inclusion to make the Holy Family appear like a normal family. So there's Joseph, there's Mary, and Jesus. But Joseph is kind of just there. And what is he there for? In point of fact, Joseph is one of the great heroes of our faith, one of the greatest ingredients in the profile of the Messiah. You can see that, I think, if you glance backwards in this chapter to the first 18 verses or so. Matthew begins his account by tracing Jesus' genealogy as the son of Abraham and the son of David. And he traces that genealogy down from that beginning, Abraham, verse 2, through David, verse 6, right down to Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called Christ. And you see how very carefully the author, Matthew, is describing this. He is Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called Christ. Now, in Luke's gospel, you have the backstory of Mary herself. Matthew, however, gives us Joseph's story. And as we read this evening, it's not pretty. To begin with, in verses 18 and 19, it begins with these words. Now the birth, literally the word there means the generation of Jesus Christ took place in this way. It's talking about the origin or the source, not the birth as such, but where he came from. He came from somewhere. He did not come from a normal sexual union. He came from this action of the Holy Spirit, we're told, because Mary was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. If you go to Luke's gospel, he gives you much more detail, of course. He gives you detail about the miraculous working of the Holy Spirit in the womb of Mary. But Matthew does give us some information. He gives us the same information in an abbreviated form. The Holy Spirit, who comes onto the stage in Genesis chapter 1, right at the very beginning, I think it's verse 2 of chapter 1, as he's brooding over the unformed chaos of the initial creation, the Holy Spirit who brings order and brings it all together and breathes life into the creatures and especially into human beings. The Holy Spirit has been active in the production of this child. And the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of creativity, the Spirit of creation, the Spirit of God, has created in Mary's womb the Christ child. Matthew, however, does focus on Joseph's reaction to the news, not knowing, of course, what we know, because Matthew's told us she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. That bit of information is not accessible to Joseph. Joseph has just heard the news that his wife-to-be, his engaged, betrothed, is pregnant. And Matthew captures Joseph's agony. It points up his integrity and his tenderness. We're told that as he considered these things, he didn't just rush to a conclusion, he considered these things. He looked at it from every angle possible. And as he considered these things, he resolved to divorce her because he felt that was the right thing to do. But he resolved to divorce her quietly because that would protect her and her place in society. So we see his integrity, we see his tenderness. He'd already made up his mind. That's made very clear that he would divorce her, but he would divorce her quietly. And it's at this point in the story that the divine representative appears, an angel from the Lord, a messenger of the Lord. Here is God sending a messenger directly to speak to this man, Joseph. It's very, very likely, knowing what we know about Mary, that she had not told Joseph anything about the angel who had appeared to her. It's very likely that she had kept that knowledge to herself, because we know that that was a characteristic of Mary. In two places in Luke's gospel, in chapter 2, verse 19, and chapter 2, verse 51, we're told that she kept knowledge of unusual events very close to her chest, in her heart, we're told. In other words, she does not talk easily about things or about everything that happened to her. And in this case, how likely would Joseph have been to believe her? So the angel comes. And the angel comes after he has given the matter some thought and has decided in the course of action that he's going to take. It's at this point that the angel intervenes. Now I want to pause for a moment and say that there's actually a lesson, I think, in the order of the events as they unfold at this point. Leon Morris, an old commentator, quotes in his commentary, I think, from Psalm 112, verse 4. And that psalm reads like this: "For the upright there ariseth light in the darkness." That's obviously an old version. In the ESV it says, "Light dawns in the darkness for the upright." One of the things we're told about Joseph is that he was an upright man. We're told that in Luke's gospel. He was an upright man. He didn't know all the facts, but he had reflected on what he did know, and he'd made up his mind to do the right thing according to his best understanding. And he's proceeding along the lines that he has considered. He is right. In light of the light and knowledge that he had, he's making the right choice. And he's doing it in the right spirit. And then at this critical moment when he's made up his mind, when he's resolved to do this thing, God intervenes and gives him the guidance that he needs. Now, what strikes me is that this very often happens in our lives as well, when we find ourselves perplexed about some decision or some move in our lives. We find ourselves without any clarity, perhaps. And we do what Joseph did. We consider the matter. We consider the matter in light of what we do know. We put all that we do know into place. We bring it all to the table, and we use what we do know to come to a conclusion and to make a decision. Perhaps we're not happy with the decision. Perhaps we're not completely comfortable with the decision. But all of the factors that we've examined, all of the things we know we've done and we've looked at, the prayers that we've raised, we've added them into the mix. And so we act on the light that we have. And there's a sense in which God's happy with that. Acting on the light you have. And looking to God to send further light if and when he sees fit. And I think many of our decisions in life we have to make in light of the knowledge that we have. And we cannot make those decisions infallibly. We cannot be absolutely sure. We do what we believe, considering the facts that are available to us, what we can, and we make a choice with integrity to act in a certain way, to do a certain thing, to take this job or that job or some other opportunity that lies before us. And it may very well be that God will intervene. There will be some intrusion of God's word or God's people into our minds to divert us from that. But it's okay to act on the light that you have. Joseph is doing the right thing. The angel is not telling him he's doing the wrong thing. The angel is coming to give him some information that he does not have. And that's where the angel turns up in the scheme of things. The angel of the Lord. It's very interesting here that there are three divine characters introduced right at the very beginning of the book of Matthew in this first part of the narrative of the book of Matthew. There's the Lord who sends his messenger. There's the Holy Spirit who has been at work in this miraculous and supernatural way in the womb of Mary. And there's the child to be born who is God with us. Here we have, theologically speaking, the inseparable operations of the triune God in their action outside of God. Whenever God acts towards created reality, he acts inseparably, but according to the particulars of the person involved. So the angel of the Lord comes to speak to him. He refers to the work of the Holy Spirit, and he names, there's this divine naming of this child who is to be born. His name is Immanuel, God with us. And the quotation in verse 22 and 23 is from our passage in Isaiah. I don't want to spend much time in the Isaiah passage. You can go and listen to a sermon on that in our series. But let me just remind you of the story there. Ahaz is the king. Syria is the threat. Ahaz is the king of Israel. He's worried about the threat of Syria. He's out checking that there's a good water supply into the city. He's checking the walls to make sure that they're sound and that they can stave off any intrusion by Syria into Judah and Jerusalem. And he's doing all this at his own initiative. He has a prophet, but he hasn't consulted the prophet. He has the God of Israel, but he hasn't consulted the God of Israel. Ahaz is acting on his own. He's acting as a practical atheist. And Isaiah the prophet comes looking for him, and he finds him, checking everything out, making sure that if Syria attacks, everything is going to be okay. Isaiah comes to tell him, by the way, that Syria is never, ever going to be a major problem for Jerusalem. Syria will never, ever cause the fall of Jerusalem. But Ahaz is too worried for that. Ahaz doesn't believe God. Ahaz is taking things into his own hands. And Isaiah says, look, this is what God has said, and I want you, if you don't just believe me when I'm telling you that Syria isn't going to invade the city of Jerusalem, why don't you ask me? I'm a prophet of God. You ask me for a sign. God is permitting you to ask for a sign. He's stooping down to your level, and he's saying to you, if the word of the prophet isn't enough, I will give you a sign. Ask for one. It can be anything from heaven above or on the earth beneath, anything you want. And Ahaz goes all spiritual on him. I wouldn't test the Lord. Oh, dear. I wouldn't do a thing like that. I wouldn't test the Lord, my God, by asking him for a sign. Frankly, he's not interested. He's not interested in the word of God. He's not interested in proving God's word to be true. And it's at that point that Isaiah pronounces a judgment on Ahaz. You won't ask for a sign, God will give you a sign. You won't live to see this, but God will give a sign. Here's a sign that God will give you as a judgment. The virgin will conceive and bear a son, and he'll be called Immanuel. And then later in that passage, Isaiah comes back to him and says, you didn't ask for a sign, and I gave you one in the distant future. Let me give you one for right now. My wife is going to be pregnant. She's going to have a son, and his name will designate what's going to happen in the near future, and you can be sure that you're going to come under the judgment of God. That's the background of Isaiah chapter 7. And that's where we get our verse from. Here is this word from God in which God, through Isaiah, names the virgin. The word that's used there is a word for an intact virgin, and in the Greek translation, it's even clearer and more definite than that, and that's the Greek word that is used here to emphasize the virginity of Mary, the Holy Mother. And it's at this point, then, that the child is named God with us. That's the focus of our talk this evening. God with us. And this divine name, Immanuel, implies the incarnation. It implies that God will become flesh. And when you take this, that little expression, it's translated for us, by the way, you notice that. It's translated by the scriptures. It means God with us. There are two parts to that, aren't there? And each of these parts must be weighted perfectly, without one weight going one way or the other. It is God with us. God, which denotes majesty, with us, which denotes mercy. God, which denotes glory, with us, which denotes grace. God, which can strike terror into our hearts, with us, which gives confidence to our hearts. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. There's the mystery. And our language bursts its bounds whenever we reflect on God with us. Consider the two parts. God, that is the absolute, simple, infinite Jehovah. God with us, here in our flesh. Here is God, incomprehensible to us. In flesh, God with us, comprehensible in his humanity. Here is God, immaterial and eternal, unbounded and free, self-existent, self-sufficient. The God who appeared to Moses, appeared in fire that fueled itself, appeared in a thunderstorm with loud noise and flashing lights and a booming voice and terrorized people. Here's God with us, in a created human nature, in our flesh, in our humanity, God with skin on. And when we take it all together, God with us, I want you to notice that God did not change. He did not add anything to his deity. By definition, as God, he is complete and perfect. Rather, he takes on, he unites himself to our humanity, which is something alien. So here is the almighty, here is the finite, here is the independent, here is the dependent, here is the immortal, here is the mortal, here is the immaterial, here is the material, here is the underived, here is the derived, he is the creator, and here is the creature, united, God with us. And that nature he took was sinful nature, our nature. Not that he took sinful nature, but that the nature he took was the nature of people who have sinned. God sent his Son in the likeness of sinful flesh without becoming sinful himself. And you see again from the passage, we noted this earlier, but I emphasize it again, just as in creation, now in the incarnation, we have the work of the triune God, the angel of the Lord, the Holy Spirit, and Immanuel. The Trinity worked together to design, to fashion, to inhabit a human form able to sustain the indwelling of deity. Jesus says, or the Son says before the creation, he says, a body you have prepared for me. He takes on the form of a servant. He's found in fashion as a man in all the fragility and weakness of our humanity. God contracted to a span, incomprehensibly made man. The incarnation is good news for us. Isaiah talks about the news, the good news that the Lord is King and that the Lord is coming. He talks about those who are out in the mountains and who are preaching good news to the people and who are bounding over the mountains with joy because of the good news, the glad tidings of great joy for all the people. And Isaiah describes this news. It is that the King is coming. The Lord will come. The Lord will appear. And here's the answer. God with us. We know it's perfectly possible for God to be with us in a scary way. Ask Moses. Ask the children of Israel in the desert. The fire and the thunderstorm. We know that God can be with us as an angel. The angel of the Lord represents the Lord. He's the messenger of the Lord. And angels are scary. They always have to say to people when they appear, fear not. But here's the good news. God with us. We're not scared of babies. And we're not scared of little boys. And we're not scared of other people. He took on our humanity. He was one of us. Today, to you is born today a Savior, which is Christ the Lord, was the angel's message to the shepherds. The divine name then implies the incarnation. It implies presence, the presence of God. Here's the emphasis. It rests on God with us. The story of humanity is a story of people moving further and further away from God. Going their own way, doing their own thing. Each of us is turned away, says Isaiah. Each of us going in our own way. Here's God taking the initiative. He comes alongside us. He takes our nature, our flesh. He takes our human flesh to live in it, to sleep in it, to see through it, to hear by it, to touch things, taste things, feel things. He takes our flesh and bone and blood and neurons and synapses. He takes all that we are as human beings. He takes our humanity. Now we have to, as we think about this, we have to be careful how we speak of him. One of the great 19th century preachers was a man called C.H. Spurgeon. He was a very popular preacher. People from all walks of life, especially the poor and the uneducated came to hear him preach in his pulpit in London. But he didn't surrender key things that he said to them in his sermons. And so on one occasion, he warns the people, while he's preaching about the coming of Christ, he says this to the people, "Do not confound the natures, nor divide the person." He's quoting, "Do not confound the natures or divide the person. He is one person with two natures. His two natures are divine and human, God and man. But the two natures remain distinct and stable, and the divine nature remains unchanged and unchangeable. It does not adapt. It remains divine. God cannot but remain himself. But the human nature, like our human nature, is something that is growing, exercising, moving, developing, expanding the knowledge, its knowledge, and so on. Our nature is a nature that is becoming. God's nature remains stable." Now, it's very hard to put that together. It's strange language, doesn't it? But we have to say that. We have to be very careful. And as we're singing some of our Christian hymns at Christmas, this is some of the most exalted theology you're going to sing all year in these Christmas carols that we sing. Very God of very God, very man of very man. He was present. He was present in his humanity. He was present with the disciples. He sends his Holy Spirit to be present with us today. This is the great lesson of John chapter 14. When Jesus is going to leave, he says, "I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world can't receive because it neither sees him or knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you." Then Jesus says, "I won't leave you. I won't leave you orphans. I will come to you. When the Spirit comes to you, the believer, when the Spirit comes to be with you and to be in you, the Lord Jesus comes to be with you. Yet a little while," he says, "you will see me. Because I live, you will live also. In that day, you'll know that I'm in the Father, you're in me, and I in you. And he who loves me will be loved by the Father." And he goes on to say these things. And not only does the Son come to us, but the Father comes to us. And then Jesus says, "My Father and I will come to you. We will make our home with you." In other words, the entire Trinity is active in bringing the presence of God into the life of the believer. God with us. And when you read John chapter 14, 15, you discover that we're not just thinking of the Son of God being with us, as he was with the disciples during his life, nor are we thinking simply of the Holy Spirit being with us, but we're thinking of where the Spirit is, the Father is, and the Son is, the Godhead, God with us. Now get this. Jesus is saying this is the reality of what it means to be his children. You're a child of God. God is with you. He is with you wherever you go. He is with you at all times. He is with you in every stage and age of your life. He's with you when you're a child in the crib. He's with you as you're developing your life and growing as a boy or a girl. He's with you as you form relationships in your late teens and early 20s or whatever. He's with you as you get a job. He's with you in your career. He's with you as perhaps you get married or perhaps you pursue a career further as a single person. He is with you. He's with you when you're ill. He's with you when you're happy. He's with you when you're sad. He is with you. God with us is the blisteringly wonderful reality of what it means to be a child of God. Immanuel. God with us. God with us means that we are reconciled to God. God is angry with the wicked every day, so why is he not angry with his people? Because he came to reconcile. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. and we are redeemed by the blood of God. God with us means sympathy, because in our humanity, the Lord Jesus experienced what we experience in everyday life. He knew what it was to be hungry and thirsty, happy and sad. For God to be with us means that Satan is terrified. When the Lord Jesus was here in his humanity, the demons got very disturbed. They really got really annoyed. Go away from us. Go away from us. You're the Holy One of God. Go away. We can't stand for you to be around. The demons are terrified when they're confronted by men and women and boys and girls who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, in whom the Lord Jesus dwells by his Holy Spirit. Why? Because demons recognize what the world doesn't see. Demons recognize that God is with you. God with us is enough. We don't need anything other than this. We don't need anything other than God with us, Immanuel, Christ. We don't need priests to interface with God on our behalf. We don't need other mediators to interface with God on our behalf. We have God. We have God with us. The Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you and indwells you as the children of God. John Wesley, when he died with these words on his lips. May we live and die with them on our hearts. Here are the words. The best of all is God with us. The best of all is God with us. Jesus says to his disciples as he sends them out into the world, as you are sent out into the world of this week, whatever this week may hold for you, I am with you always. Here is the miracle of Christmas, Immanuel, God with us. God in our flesh, God now by his Spirit, the other Christ, another of the same kind, another helper of the same kind as Jesus is, indwelling you, bringing Christ and the Father right into your life. That's what it means to be a believer. And if you work that out, that means that no matter how lonely you feel, you're never truly alone. That means however confused you may be, you're never truly left to work it out on your own. You can do what Joseph did. What Joseph did was he considered the things that he had to do, and he decided to do what was his duty. And that's what you have to do, and I have to do in our daily lives. And sometimes God intervenes to change that. Not always, by any manner of means, but sometimes. We can trust. We can trust him. Why? Because God is with us. That, to me, it seems, is the very heart of the Christmas message. That's why you find the word Immanuel in so many Christmas cards. Most of the people who print them have no idea what they're doing, but we do. And maybe God's overruled the ignorance of the world to have them on those Christmas cards for our sake, to remind us that we are a people who know for certain that because our Savior came, God is with us until we are with him. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this great Christmas theme of Immanuel. Thank you for the Savior who came. Thank you for his life and the love he showed, patience he had, the death he died, and the exaltation he enjoys in his human nature. We thank you that the Holy Spirit brings all of God, all of you to bear on our lives. We thank you for that, and we pray that we would live in light of it to your praise and glory. Amen. And now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you, now and evermore. Amen.